Good evening, guys. On behalf of our church, there are thousands of folks praying for you 50 miles from here, and we love you, and we know what you're facing, and so we stand with you, and I just want you to know you got a bunch of folks standing with you. You've never met them. You'll get to meet them someday, but until then, they are with you in spirit and in truth, and they are holding you up in prayer, and I think that's good, don't you? Praise the Lord for that. Let's open our Bibles tonight to John 14:27. One verse, how's that? We'll look at one verse. I was thinking Pastor Steve sent me his copy of the book, actually before Overwhelmed was released. He sent it to me, he said, could you read this and tell me where I'm off? So I called him back a couple of weeks later, I said, you're off everywhere. Because we used to be real sarcastic with each other. And he said, what do you mean? I said, no, it's great. And it was a privilege to be able to kind of go through it before he released it. And man, what a good word that is. If you haven't got it, I would suggest you get it. It's a great ministry book to folks that are hurting. As I was praying about what to share with you tonight, I came across an interesting parallel. We are actually teaching the Gospel of John at our church on Sunday mornings. And I saw a lot of similarities between what you as a congregation are facing, having lost your pastor, and the apostles as they sat with Jesus at the Last Supper. And maybe it's an odd comparison, and maybe I'll try to explain it to you a little bit. The Last Supper is the lengthiest recorded discussion that we are given in the Bible between Jesus and his own. They are words from the Lord who is about to die. They are essentials. The time is short. The time has come. There really isn't anything more that we can wait upon. It needs to be said now. And John doesn't give us all of the discussions that took place, but he gives us much more than everyone else combined. In fact, over the next 6 or 7 hours that will transpire between the Passover going forward, John will take 5.5 chapters to record it. From chapter 13 to 18, less than 5 or 6 hours pass. Imagine being sent out by Jesus to prepare the Passover feast. They'd done it, the boys had, at least a couple of times before, but this seemed different somehow. The things that he had been talking about had started to bother them a little bit, and the Lord had said a couple of things that he had never said. He said, my time has come. He was always saying his time hadn't come. He looked different, sounded different. For the past year since Caesarea Philippi, the Lord had been speaking one thing to those guys. I'm going to die. I'm going to rise. I'm going to give life. They had only heard this part. I'm going to die. And that really was all that they took to heart. And I don't think that any of them in planning this evening, that they could have anticipated what this evening would hold in centuries to come, this Last Supper. I think sometimes days get frozen in our minds because of the magnitude of them. They just change you forever. I suspect all of you remember where you were on 9/11. It's just a day that just registers. And even though it's been, 13 and a half years ago, or 13 years and a little bit ago, I'll bet that to this day you remember where you were. If you're older, you might remember D-Day. It was a day where in June of 6th, 1944, some 160,000 troops landed along a 50-mile stretch of beach to try to chase back and fight off the Nazis at Normandy. And if you were alive then, what a day that was. The bombing of Pearl Harbor 3 years earlier on December 7th, 1941, or maybe if you're a little younger, the assassination of John F. Kennedy. It was a huge blow to the nation, certainly. Everyone was so shocked. He died on November 23rd, 1963. Or if you're a rock and roll guy like I did, I still remember when John Lennon was killed in December of 1980. Or when the earthquake hit Whittier. Or the day my parents died. Or as you are dealing with the loss of a very good and faithful and loving pastor. As of today, I have lived 22,302 days. Don't you start trying to figure out how old I am. But there are really only a handful of them that changed my life. Most of them kind of come and go. They kind of wash away into almost, you know, I can't remember. But there are some days I absolutely remember. I remember to this day the night that I gave my life to Christ. I remember the day that my first wife died at 25 years old of leukemia at the City of Hope. I remember my mother's death and my father's. I remember the night my wife and I got married, who's here tonight, almost 35 years ago. I tricked her. She stayed. I remember the day I became a father and the day I became a grandfather. I remember the day that we began our church, Morningstar Christian Chapel, with three couples in a living room in Whittier in 1985. But there are thousands of days I don't recall at all. But those were special. Those are memorable days that left impressions upon me that I will never forget. And I know that though the apostles didn't know it then, this was one of those nights. It was a night that was so burned into John the apostle's memory that 60 years later, when all of the apostles were gone and he was the original guy left, he wrote of it with such passion and with such unforgettable kind of phraseology, and he just applied it so well that the old John in his 90s was still feeling the effects of that day. You're going to have nights like that in your life. A whole bunch of them are just going to come and go. But there's going to be those special days and special times when God reveals things that he has in store that you hadn't planned for at all. You had no idea was coming. Some of them will be welcomed with great joy. Others of them will overwhelm you, at least for a time. But they all fall into the hands and into the plans and into the ways of the Lord. When Jesus sat down with the disciples, he was well aware of their anxious and confused hearts, because what they had been hearing this night was not at all in line with their expectations. Now understand, the apostles operated like every other Jew. When the Messiah comes, he'll be like Moses, he'll be a political leader, he'll be an earthly deliverer, he'll put us back on top instead of being subjugated to some other power, and we're going to rule and reign. Which is why you find for 3.5 years the disciples arguing who the greatest was and where their jobs are going to be, even hiring their mom or talking to their mom into going to Jesus to put in the good word. That was their expectation. But then they sat down on this night to dinner, and they began to hear what Jesus had to say, and he will tell them more than once, what I'm telling you now, you won't understand now. You'll get it later. It won't sink in. You won't be able to comprehend it. You can't put two and two together and get four right now, but I'm telling you this now. And so you read in places like John 2:22 and other places where John says, and after he was risen, then we understood. Then we got what he was saying. But they didn't get it now. So understand that at this dinner and in these words that Jesus is sharing, they are words of comfort and hope and joy and explanation of purpose and plan, what he would do, what they will do, what he wanted to do with them. But a lot of it was going in one ear, out the other, because they were distraught. They had sat at the dinner table. They had heard that there was a betrayer in their midst, and no one knew who it was. And there was only 12 of them in the room. Jesus had told Peter, who was shooting off his mouth like usual, "Before tomorrow, you'll have denied me 3 times. And no one wanted to believe that. And then the Lord says, and by the end of this evening, all of you will run off. Because as the scripture says, you smite the shepherd and the sheep, they'll scatter. Jesus said he was leaving. They couldn't follow. As you read through these chapters, and it's good to read them, I think, in just one sitting to get the impact, you will find Peter and Thomas and Philip and the other Judas, not Iscariot, arguing with the Lord. Where are you going? Why can't we go now? I will die for you. We don't know where you're going, and we don't know the way. Just show us the Father. It'll suffice us. How are you going to make yourself known to us and to nobody else? They were scared. They had left home and family, and let's face it, hanging around with Jesus at this time was not a good proposition. Way too many people wanted to kill him. And you'd left home, and you, for the most part, weren't even in your neck of the woods. You're in Jerusalem. You come from your city up in the north. What do you mean you're leaving? What do you mean you're going? And what did the Lord say to them? He had given them great comfort. He said, look, I'm the way. I'm the truth and the life. He had said to them, I'm God. You've always believed in God. Now believe also in me. Don't let your heart be troubled. Don't let it be afraid. I'm going to go prepare a place for you. And when I go, I'm going to come back and get you. And it went like this. Yeah, because this isn't making any sense. We want a Messiah who's going to take over. The Romans are going to get out. We're moving into the White House. That's what they wanted. You've seen me, Philip. You've seen the Father. I'm going to the Father. I'm going to send you another helper. I'm not going to leave you orphans. I'm going to come to you. You're going to continue the work that I've begun. In fact, greater works than these will you do because I'm going to the Father. And it went in this ear, and it went out that ear. The Holy Spirit's coming. He's going to remind you of what I've taught you. He's going to teach you things that you haven't been able to learn. If you love me, you'll keep my commandments, and I'll come with my Father, and we'll make ourselves at home with you. And the Holy Spirit who's been with you, he's going to dwell in you. Those are pretty powerful statements. But it didn't comfort these men because they had different ideas. They didn't see a need for the cross. I guarantee you they didn't see Jesus as God yet. Good man, good prophet, Messiah, let's cross our fingers. The two on the road to Emmaus will say to the Lord in a few days from now, discouraged, and they're going home, we had thought he was the one. We were wrong. But then you come to this verse that we wanted to look at tonight, and it's such a powerful verse, but again, it is lost upon the disciples until the resurrection, because then as the Holy Spirit comes to dwell in them and teaches them his word, it all makes sense. For you, you can get it tonight, because we're well on this side of the cross, on the outpouring of God's Spirit. And God is willing to bring this promise home to your heart even this evening. It's an amazing verse. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give it to you. So let not your heart be troubled, and neither let it be afraid. Here's Jesus' words to those he loved that he was training who were in such a dire condition because of a lack of fully seeing his plan. And it is the Lord's word to them about peace. And I want you to think about tonight, just for the next 30 minutes or so, how much peace, God's peace, rules in your heart tonight? The Hebrew word, shalom. The Greek word, eirene. And eirene is an interesting word because it means more than just the cessation of trouble. And that's usually the way we hear it. There's peace, which means what? There's no trouble. That's the way we usually use the word. But yet, from God's standpoint, and certainly from the Greek language itself, it means an active enjoyment of rest from God's hand. It is the positive side of peace that Jesus speaks about here. It's one thing to just get rid of all your trouble. It's another thing to have rest. The world just knows the negative definition, the absence of trouble. But God's promised peace, as you well know, is unrelated to circumstance. It has nothing to do with circumstance. Because God's in charge. All right, I am at peace. It's a rest that he alone can give. And you may tonight, like Jesus was facing the cross, or the disciples were facing what they thought was a horrendous situation. You may be facing tonight some real heartache and difficulty, but you can still have peace, God's peace. Paul said to the Philippians in chapter 4, I have learned in whatever condition I am to be content. That contentment doesn't rely upon what he did or did not have. Your peace tonight has nothing to do with what you're facing. It has everything to do with who you know. And if you know him well enough and are convinced of who he is, tonight you can have peace. in the midst of it all, great peace. Now, Paul said it to the Philippi church, and Paul was in the church, and then he was arrested and beaten, and you remember he and Silas, beaten, were thrown into the prison, and they sang worship songs at midnight. Can you imagine? Paul saying to Silas, how do you sing that? Ain't it grand to be a Christian song again? It ain't so grand now. And the Lord came and met him there, and Paul was faithful to the Lord. He ministered to the jailer and to his family. Where can you find the kind of peace that is more than the absence of trouble, but is the settled kind of internal personal rest that is unaffected by life or by its setbacks? And the most definitive words come here from the lips of Jesus on the night he would head for the cross. He knew what was coming. He had peace. I think that's the kind of peace God wants for you and I. The peace of Jesus that brings calm in the midst of the most fearful of circumstance, that can hush a cry and still a riot and rejoice even in pain and trial and sing in the midst of suffering. It's the kind of peace that's not overcome by circumstance, but overcomes it. Look, think about real peace for a minute. I think that anyone in the world that is honest with you would give away all that they have for 5 minutes of it. But here's the interesting thing about peace. Like joy, biblically, peace is a byproduct. What I mean by that is you can't get up in the morning and say, today, I'm going to be joyful. Big smile on your face. I don't care if it's all crowded. I'm having a joyful day. You can't chase it. You can't find it that way. Peace is the exact same way. It is a byproduct of a life that has been surrendered to the Lord. You can't find peace by pursuit or by determination. Or I'm going to be peaceful, I'm going to be restful, I'm going to be joyful, I'm going to be happy, you're going to be miserable. You'll never be able to accomplish it. We want peace. And look at the world, man. They pursue peace, but it always eludes them. 3,000 years of recorded history, less than 8% of those years was there any peace around the world. There are thousands of peace treaties scattered abroad, signed and broken. And the reason is the fruit of the Spirit is peace. Notice what we read here, peace I leave with you. That's what Jesus said to his apostles. The New Testament speaks about two kinds of peace. There is an objective peace. And what I mean by that is the objective peace has to do with your relationship to God. And then there's a subjective peace, and that is the experience that you experience, or the feelings and the outgrowth, if you will, or the outflow of that relationship. So the objective and then the subjective. The first is not a feeling. The objective peace is a settled fact. The second is a feeling that is produced by the first. The natural man lacks peace with God. Why? Well, the Bible tells us that you and I were born into a world that was fighting with God. It was a rebellion that Adam and Eve started and that we signed up for the minute we were born. We're in on the rebellion. Romans, I think, chapter 5, verse 10, but if it isn't that, I didn't say it. Says we were the enemies of God. Now, here's what happened. You got saved at some point in your life, hopefully, or if not, you can get saved tonight. But here's the deal. You get saved, and the war with God stops. We come to Jesus. We cease being God's enemy. We make a truce. We hold up the white flag. We surrender. I give. You're the Lord. Have it your way. And we change sides, right? And the hostilities cease, and the treaty that is made between God and I is written in the blood of Jesus so that I have peace with God. It's a covenant of peace. It's an objective fact. It takes place where you can't see, but you know it to be so. And I come to the Lord and I surrender and I have peace with God. Paul called the good news the preparation of the gospel of peace, Ephesians chapter 6, because the gospel brings men at war with God to be at peace with him. Romans 5, isn't it? Verse 1, having therefore been justified by faith, we have peace with God. So you and God come together because of Jesus. Your sins are forgiven. The rebellion stops. The war is over. That's God's wonderful plan, right? I think Paul said to the Colossians, he has made peace through his blood on the cross. So that's what Jesus did, right? For us. You believe that, don't you? That the sinful man cannot come into the presence of a holy God unless something is done about that sinful man's life. Well, Jesus did that. He dies for sin. He imputes or puts into our account his righteousness. It's almost as if God is on one side and we're on the other, and Jesus takes the hand of both and he places his bloody hand on top of them. And he brings us together as one. We were estranged, we are reconciled. That's the heart of the gospel message. 2 Corinthians 5, 17, 18, 19. Subjective peace. Or I should say objective peace. The work of God. But Jesus is not talking about his objective peace here. Doesn't even apply. The peace that he is offering his disciples is subjective. It is experiential. It is a rest that, rather than leaving you as a victim, makes you an overcomer. Look, I give you my peace. My peace I leave with you. The peace of God. It is supernatural. That's good. It is permanent. It is positive. It has no side effects. It is a rest that the Lord wants to pass on to you. It is the calm of your heart after the storm of Calvary. It is the firm conviction that he who spared not his own son will also with him now freely give us all things. It is the peace that tells us, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known unto God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. That's a wonderful peace to have, isn't it? The peace of God is not based on circumstance. That's the way the world does it. So it doesn't make any sense to a carnal mind if you just lost your job as a Christian. You go, I think God has better plans for me. And they look at you and say, you're a nut. You're not dealing with reality. You're living in a fantasy world. And your response is, oh, no, no, no. I'm living in the real world here. I have a God who loves me, is for me, not against me. He's going to provide all of my needs. I don't know what he's up to. And that can be a great source of worry unless I'm confident that he's for me and not against me. And that he will do what he has said. Which is why Paul describes it as a peace that surpasses comprehension. It doesn't seem reasonable to anyone outside of the body of Christ that you could have peace in the midst of difficulty. But that's because this supernatural work of God can't be described on a physical level. I don't know how to explain that. I don't know how to talk about that. Let the peace of God guard your heart and mind. The word guard is a military word. It means to stand at a post and keep the enemy out. Let the peace of God stand at a post and keep the enemy out. So if peace is on guard, you're inside an impregnable citadel where you can't be gotten to. That's good to know, isn't it? I just stay right here with the peace of God. It stands guard to keep me from worrying, which will corrode my heart. It stands guard to keep me from having unworthy thoughts that will corrupt or tear up my mind. It's the kind of peace everyone longs for, that deals with the past, that can't torture me, that governs the present so that I don't have any dissatisfaction in my life because I've got peace. God's in charge. And it produces a hope for the future so I don't have to fear the unknown. God will give me peace. It delivers me from the guilt of the past and the trials of the present and the worries about the future. But I want you to notice something else. He said, peace I leave with you, that subjective relationship. But then he says these words, my peace I give to you. My peace. God wants you to have the peace that Jesus had. I like that. I don't know if I can get to that, but I like that. The peace of God is not available to those who have no peace with God because we serve the Prince of Peace. Here is the key to how supernatural this peace is. It's his peace. Now you read through the Gospels again. You watch Jesus stand before Pilate, so calm, so in control, so aware of the Father's will, so unmoved by the whole thing. It irritated Pilate. Pilate finally said to Jesus, "You're not going to answer me? You know, I hold your life in my hands." And Jesus just went, "No, I don't think so. I have the power to crucify you, the power to release you." Yeah, not so much. "You wouldn't have any power at all against me unless it had been given to you from above." That peace. Take it. It's yours. The kind that he gives to us. It is undistracted, fearless trust. When Peter finally showed up at Cornelius' house there in Acts chapter 10 after a good work of God to get him there, he looked around the room and saw these Gentiles sitting in every corner hungry for the word of the Lord. And he said, "The word which God sent to the children of Israel was to preach peace through Jesus Christ. And now I'm here to do that for you." Paul wrote to the Thessalonians who were so distraught. And he wrote to the end of the book, "May the Lord of peace himself give you peace in every way." You know what Jesus wants to give you tonight is the peace that he battle tested. Look at the way Jesus handled himself under all of the pressure and spitting and mockery and murder plans and all that he faced. And he had just solid peace, didn't he? And he wants you to live like that. Hey, it worked for him. Now you put it on. Not as the world gives. Notice what he says. I can't give you the peace like the world gives, but I'll give you my peace. The world's peace is worthless. You know that. I hope you know that. It's shallow. It's unfulfilling. It is an attempt in a different way every day to try to handle your problems, whether it's alcohol or drugs or entertainment or some other kind of escapism. Here's the truth about all of that. You're not going to find any peace out there. There is no peace without God. So you can't put blinders on and go to bed and hope you forget. It's futile. In fact, I would say this to you, if an unbeliever knew what was waiting for them, that little peace would go away too. The truth is that the reason a person can't find peace has nothing to do with his emotions or his environment. It's not his mom's fault or his experience as a kid or grandma didn't treat me good or my teacher was rotten. The only reason you don't have peace is you don't have Jesus. He's the one who brings peace. Man's heart is desperately wicked. That's why we don't have peace. You know, when Judah in Jeremiah's day was facing the opposition of the Babylonians that were coming, and Jeremiah spent 50 years, imagine that, without a convert preaching to the children of God. Get it together, man. Judgment is coming. The enemy is coming. You're going to get overthrown. And for a long time, he said, if you'll repent, the Lord can turn your enemy away. And then it got to be like D-Day, and it went beyond, and the Lord said to Jeremiah, the message changes starting today. From now on, here's the message, surrender or you die. And the people that surrendered went into captivity, and those who didn't die. But in the midst of that time in Jeremiah chapter 6, Jeremiah began to speak about the false prophets who walked around saying, peace, peace. He said, there is no peace, there was no peace, but they slightly tried to heal the hurt of my people by saying peace. They should be ashamed of themselves and learn how to blush before the Lord. That message is not going to bring them peace at all. And they tried to patch it up, but it didn't work. We expect nothing different in our last days. The world doesn't exist in peace. It doesn't know peace. But we know God, don't we? We know him. Notice what he says. Jesus says, I'll leave you peace. It'll be my peace. And it won't be like the world, but it'll be mine. So you don't have to be troubled in heart or afraid of what's coming. You can just take my peace. And here's the deal. God's peace has to be received. You have to be able to lay hold of it tonight and grab hold upon it. That's the difficult part. We like reading Bible verses out here. God wants them in here. You can't just do a memory verse and go, all right, I've said it 1,000 times, I still feel nothing. No, you've got to receive what God has said. He says this, I give you peace, don't let your heart be troubled. The peace he gives has to be applied. If we believe him, then we can be unmoved. A fearful heart is usually found in someone who doesn't fully trust the Lord. And I found, at least over the years, and maybe you have as well, that anxiety and turmoil seldom live in the present tense. Trouble is usually based on the past or on the future, what I've been going through or what I think I'm going to face, which is why, you know, we are told there in Matthew, Jesus said there in the Sermon on the Mount, don't worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow will bring its own troubles. Sufficient today is the worry of it or the trouble of it. So the Lord says, I give you my peace. Now don't worry. Don't let your heart be anxious. Take my peace. Let me give you the peace I've promised. When Paul wrote to the Colossians in chapter 3, he said, let the peace of God rule in your hearts. And it's a great word because the word rule is the Greek word brabuo. And brabuo means to umpire, as a baseball umpire or someone that would referee a fight. And so Paul says to the Colossians, let the peace of Christ be the umpire in your heart when it comes to the way that you live. You have a choice. I can worry or fear, fret, be anxious, lie awake at night, you know, be overwhelmed, or I can let God's peace rule. Let his peace make the decision. Let it be the one that sets before you the direction in which you should go. How often do you find the enemy whispering those words to your ear about worry and you, oh yeah, you know, I hadn't thought of that. That's really upsetting. And Jesus, here's your peace. Don't be troubled. All right, Lord, I'll just worry over here for just a minute. I'll be right back. Paul, when he wrote to the Corinthians, said, you know, five times I've received 39 lashes from the Jews. Three times I've been beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Three times I was shipwrecked. I've spent a day and night in the deep. I've frequently been on journey, danger from rivers and robbers and countrymen and Gentiles in city and the wilderness and the sea. I've been in danger from false brethren. I've been in labor and hardship. I've had many sleepless nights. I've been hungry and thirsty, oftentimes without food. I've been cold and I've been exposed. And then there's the care of all of the churches. And you read that and you go, yeah, that's a bummer. What in the world is going on? And all you have to do is read five verses later. He writes, but we don't lose heart. Our outward man is decaying. But we're not despairing. We're being crushed, but we're not perplexed. We're being forsaken, but we're not struck down. We're being destroyed and carrying about in our body the dying of the Lord Jesus so that his life could be manifest in us. And then he said this, it's just a light affliction. Like people who are understated, beaten up, tossed in the drink, about drowned, about died. Yeah, it was nothing. But he said this, for momentarily light affliction is producing in us an eternal weight of glory far beyond comparison. So we're looking at the things which are not seen, for the things which we see are temporal, the things which we aren't seeing are eternal. How do you live that kind of peace? You focus on the promises of God. I would suggest to you, if you feel like you're lacking peace tonight, one of the ways you can go about recovering it is go home and make a list of everything you know God has done and everything you know God has said, and then making sure that it applies to you, not just to someone else. Is God for you? Amen. Yes or no? Is he for you? Will he leave you? Will he finish what he started? Does he love you? Are his plans good? Always? Always. And you should rejoice in them. Do things always work out the way you want? No, they don't. But they'll always work out the way he wants if you surrender. I can't give you any comfort that if you're not walking with the Lord tonight and things are going bad, they're going, well, whatever the Lord wants. No, I think he might just be beating you over the head then. But if you're right where he is, then you can rest. Then you can rest. Will you understand what he's doing? No. Will you like it? Probably not. I have more arguments with the Lord in my car. In the pulpit, I'm supposed to be for the Lord. In my car, we argue. Come on, Lord, I can't believe. I've been praying for 6 months and still I haven't heard a thing, Lord. Come on. And then you got to get out and go, but Lord, your will be done. If you know the things that you know, you can lean on them when you're facing things you don't understand. And God will bring you through. Let the peace of God rule in your hearts. Perfect peace comes to those whose eyes are off the problem, right? What did Isaiah say in chapter 26, verse 3? Steadfastness of mind, right? You will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed upon you because he trusts in you. It's hard to grow up, isn't it, spiritually? We just want to read the Bible and feel good, and then when things go wrong, we want to feel bad and complain. We don't want to get past this to, Lord, what are you up to? And I just want to trust you, and I put my mind on you, and rather than getting torn down this road or that road, I'm going to focus on you. You who are for me and who has come to redeem me. No wonder the psalmist could say in Psalm 46, verse, I think it's verse 10. Man, I should be looking ahead before I say that. Be still and know that I'm God. Be still and know that I'm God. And to those whose minds are fixed on him, now you have God's peace. Paul said to the Philippians towards the end of the book, from prison on death row, he writes a book about joy. He's a crazy guy. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. I know you guys have gone through some tough times, and I suspect that your best years are ahead of you if the Lord should tarry. What is God up to? Steve was a young man. I'm 2 years younger than he was. But, you know, when you get to be 60-something, you feel like that's the new 30. You expect to be around for a while, but you don't really know if you will be, do you? But we're going to be here tonight, and we're going to serve the Lord tonight with all that we got. And if it's over tonight, then it's over tonight. But we're going to go out serving him. You want an explanation for why God's doing what he's doing? You're going to have to ask him. I can't speak for him in that regard. I just know he's good. I just know he's for me. I just know he's given me his peace. And if I will live in faith, believing his word, nothing shall by any means hurt me. No weapon formed against me is going to get to me. The devil can scream and yell, but he's defeated and he's done. I'm going to heaven. My name is in the book of life. I can't wait. But wait we do. Which is why the Lord said, when he comes, will he find faith upon the earth? Look, we need to hang on to his peace. You know, the world is filled with platitudes. And I remember when my wife died years ago, I had people come up to me. And I was a young pastor, and there were thousands of people at her funeral. And they said this, folks that didn't always know, look, your wife is much better off now, they said. And I thought, that doesn't help me at all. Even though I know that that's true, she had loved the Lord and walked with him, that didn't comfort me for 5 seconds. Someone else said to me that day of her funeral, things will get better with time. I went, thanks for nothing. And they're right. Things do get better with time. I think when you lose people that you love, a couple of things I've learned, they always die too young. My grandma was 87. I loved her. She died too young. My wife was 25, too young. Did a funeral for a 7-year-old little girl a couple of months ago, too young. Doesn't matter how old you are. If you love someone, they die too young, don't they? That's what love does. But it changes you forever, and I think it should. Pastor Steve changed your life, didn't he? And it should continue that way. You should never be the same. Legacies are born out of influence. But you got stuff to do. You can look back for a while, but you got to move on. You got to get going. You got peace, man. There's a world out there that needs Jesus. So grieve and then go and let God use you. I was real glad when I opened my Bible after my wife passed away and read these words, I am the resurrection and the life. If you believe in me, even if you die, you're going to live. That I could count on. The next part of the verse says, and if you live believing in me, you'll never die. That's pretty cool, isn't it? Death doesn't look the same. Why? Because I have his peace. But then 5 words follow to Martha there in John 11. Jesus said, Martha, do you believe that? Because you see, everything that God can do for you depends upon your ability and your willingness to let him be God. You want to argue with him? You're going to lose. You want to stand away angry of how he's handled things? Then you suffer. But if you believe that God is for you and that he does all things well, oh, man, you'll be in step with him before you know it. And the good things of God will come in your direction, and you'll have a peace that passes all understanding. People go, what's wrong with you? And you go, I don't know. I'm saved, I guess. Father, tonight as we sit together with a congregation that loves you, and though you have decided that their pastor needed to be in glory, they are not, Lord, overwhelmed with grief because they have your peace. And it is a peace that we don't deserve. We certainly can't produce, but it is one that flows from our life solely because we've come to know our God. And we know things about him, Lord, that you have taught us that are really not able to be set aside, nor are they ever to be doubted, or will they ever be overcome. To a group of very fearful apostles on the night, Lord, when you'd be arrested and beaten and crucified by morning, you gave to these disciples a peace that they didn't understand, but they would in the days that would follow. In fact, in the years that would follow, every one of them but John would be murdered for their faith, and none of them would back away from that ultimate sacrifice because they were so convinced of who you were. They had peace. And I pray that for us tonight, that we would have a confidence in our God that was such that the peace of God ruled and reigned in us. If tonight you don't have peace, would you stand up right where you're at? I want to pray for you right now, that the Lord does something miraculous. Just stand right where you're at. I'm going to pray for you right now. Come on, get up. You know it's you. You want God to do something, then rise to the occasion. Anyone else? All right. The Lord knows. There's no sin in saying, Lord, I need peace. There's a lot of foolishness in saying, I guess I don't need it. Oh, you do. And the worry of this life, man, it can just terrorize. Tonight, we're going to ask the Lord to grant you his peace. And Father, as you look at the hearts of our brothers and sisters that are standing up, and I know that, Lord, there is that internal terror of fear and depression and worry and anxiety that we can hide so well on the outward, and yet it can just consume us from within. And it can be caused by a million things, but it is only healed by one. A firmer foundation, a truer conviction of who you are. And an assurance that, Lord, you don't lie. You don't play word games. You don't parse sentences. You don't say something you don't mean. You don't offer something you can't deliver. And so tonight, Lord, for my brethren that are standing in our family, grant to them, Lord, supernaturally your peace tonight. So their hearts wouldn't be troubled or afraid. By the Holy Spirit, fall upon them, Lord, in such a way that they would have a rest that they have escaped them for maybe months and years. As they begin to realize, Lord, of who you are and what you've done and what you've said, that there really is no one else that could say what you've said and do it, but you can and you have and you will. Let not your heart be troubled. Amen. Lord, my heart tonight does not need to be troubled. Leave us your peace by the power of your Spirit. And upon these lives that are standing tonight, may a miracle take place. And may peace invade a heart. And your joy be their strength. We thank you, Lord. We thank you that you give us what we cannot get on our own. We love you with all of our hearts, and may you help us to trust you with all that we have, so your peace rules in Jesus' name. Amen. Shall we all stand?